Hey guys, Daniel Theodore here with the one and only legend, Judo Jean LaBelle. How's it going, sir?
You really give a damn?
I do. You're a legend in so many different avenues. I give a damn, and any red-blooded American should give a damn.
Well, Daniel, is that as good as $5 cash?
No, I'd rather have $5 cash, but I'll take an interview with you.
I thought you were on a diet and you didn't need the money for food. You don't eat at the Midnight Mission anymore?
No, they'll cover Subway nowadays.
Maybe. Oh, well, that's good food, too.
You were the AAU National Judo Champion in 1954 and 55 in both divisions, correct?
Well, I won the heavyweight division as a light heavyweight. Then when all the groups go together, the champions of each group go together and they get the overall champion. And for 2 years, I won that.
So how old were you when you started judo?
Oh, God, about seven.
Wow.
I boxed a couple years before that. Oranges, apples.
That leads me to the next question. You fought the top-ranked middleweight boxer, Milo Savage, in the first ever U.S. sanctioned mixed rules or MMA fight in 1963.
Let's clear that up. He was rated number 5 in the world. Great fighter, Milo Savage. He fought 5 world champions, never got knocked off his feet. But he was so good, the good fighters didn't want to fight him. So I participated in the first televised mixed martial art event. And now you see him every week on television.
You had a lot to do with it. How did that one go? It went 4 rounds?
It went 4 rounds. It's actually supposed to be 10 rounds. Then the promoters and their guys came up and said it's to a finish. And I says, well, what's a finish? He says, till the first one's unconscious. So if you break a leg or break an arm, he might still be given the Tasmanian twitch and he'd be awake. So he either has to knock me out with brass knuckles that he was wearing.
Yeah, he had loaded gloves. You think he had brass knucks underneath his gloves?
No doubt about it. I saw him. And so did my trainer, Larry Korn, saw him also. He said, before he went in, he says, you're not going to fight him. But, you know, when you're young and full of piss and whatever, you don't give a damn. You think you can beat the world. But try to use your brain.
So how did you finish him off?
Well, you can buy the movie, it's only like 20 bucks, at jeanlabelle.com, GeneLebelle.com.
And pick up his book, Encyclopedia to 1,000 Submission Holds while you're there, too. And you'll be disappointed.
And you can see who won the fight. And it was spectacular.
It's 1963. This is 30 years exactly before the first UFC in America. That's being a trailblazer.
Yeah, it's a trailblazer, and it's nice to make a few bucks while you're doing your little shtick. But it's a stupid thing to do. But now in the MMA, you have the commissions all over the world. You have 2 or 3 doctors that are signed, and they say, why do they have more than one doctor? Well, if somebody gets hurt and needs stitches, one doctor takes the man to the hospital, and the other one is ready for the next event. And so nowadays, under the sanction of the athletic commissions, it's very professional, and they're very safety conscious.
You also worked a lot of matches as a pro wrestler. You ran the NWA for many, many years in the LA area, correct?
I wrestled pro for many years. My family had an auditorium called the Olympic Auditorium for 38 years. And there I met world champion wrestlers, boxers, and got a chance to work out with most of them. It was a great learning experience.
You learned a lot of holds from that kind of background.
Oh yeah, and
show holds and real.
Yeah, but everything with the wrestlers I worked with, like Carl Gotch, Lou Thesz, Vic Christie, they were all the real thing. And the clowns, I just didn't care about. Because they're all short-lived and they get hurt a lot because they can't really wrestle that well. They might have dyed hair and long hair and walk like a fruitcake, but...
Gorgeous George action?
Well, Gorgeous George...
You liked him, though. He was a good show.
...was George Wheeler. And my mother, Eileen Eaton, who was a promoter at the Olympic for 38 years and had the auditorium, he got him started as a cartoon figure. She was down at the Olympic, and he was there too, and I was also there. And she says, I have to leave and go have my hair done. She says, George, you want your hair done? Because he had long hair. He says, yeah. So he went down there. They dyed his hair pink or whatever it was, white or golden. He had these bobby pins. And they're called gold bobby pins. And I looked at them. They weren't real gold, but anyway... in the wind is Gorgeous George, had himself a stick man who got in the ring and did perfume to purify the air. And he was quite a novelty.
For the character.